Hi, folks, and welcome to The New Fly Fisher. I'm your host, Ray Plourde. And today, I'm with one of my very best friends in the world and one of Nova Scotia's top guides, Robert Chesso, who happens to be lucky enough to live here in Cape Breton Island next to this beautiful salmon river, the Margaree. So, it's late September, Robert. What can we expect here on the Margaree?
Well, in late September, we already have our summer run fish that have been in the river for, you know, the last couple of months. Mm-hmm. And we're actually starting to see the beginning of our fall run.
Ooh, that's nice.
Which is always exciting.
Yes, it is. So, do you think we've got a pretty good chance?
Well, we always have a chance at some fish, Ray.
Okay.
Why don't we go out and try?
Lead on, McDuff.
All right.
Let him go back to live another day.
And away he goes. Great fish. Wow.
Oh, baby.
Look at that fish.
Stop, wiggle.
The New Fly Fisher has been made possible thanks to the support of Cape Breton Island, where your heart will never leave. Orvis Sporting Traditions. Islander Precision Reels. Rail Riders Outdoor Clothing, the toughest clothes on the planet. Net Staff, the world's first wading staff and net. Scientific Anglers.
On today's show, the New Fly Fisher crew heads east to Canada's maritime provinces and the beautiful island of Cape Breton, Nova Scotia. Condé Nast readers have called Cape Breton one of the most scenic islands in the world. Travel and Leisure magazine awarded it the number one island destination in North America. And National Geographic has called it one of the places of a lifetime. I have to agree. Today, we're headed to the majestic Cape Breton Highlands, a land of old, rugged, round-top mountains, stunning ocean vistas, and impressive seaside cliffs. Inland, the island is covered with a canopy of beautiful hardwood forests featuring several productive salmon rivers. And the queen of them all is the lovely Margaree. On today's show, we're guests at the charming and historic Normaway Inn, which is conveniently located in the heart of the Margaree River Valley and close to all the top pools on the river. The Margaree River is roughly 50 miles long and flows in a distinct J shape from its birth in the upper mountains just south of the Cape Breton Highlands National Park to its conclusion in the Gulf of St. Lawrence at Margaree Harbor. The river has a long and storied history and has been attracting anglers from far and wide for well over 150 years. Today, the Margaree is still considered one of Canada's finest Atlantic salmon rivers and is one of a handful of national heritage rivers, in part because of its healthy runs of salmon. The lower river meanders over a broad pastoral floodplain and is at its widest below Margaree Forks, where the main stem Northeast Margaree River meets the smaller Southwest branch. The upper 30 miles are a rough and tumble wilderness area designated as a sanctuary for the fish and off limits to angling. The lower 20 miles, with some 40 classic Atlantic salmon pools and lots of pockets and runs, are free and open to anyone with a provincial salmon license and the time to learn the river. Thanks to a long-standing act of legislation in Nova Scotia, all waters in the province are deemed to be public, which means there's no privately owned water and no daily access fees or guide requirements. Anglers are therefore free to fish where they wish, when they wish. The result is, without a doubt, the best bargain in the world for quality Atlantic salmon fishing. So, If you're an angler on a budget who's always dreamed of fishing for Atlantic salmon, but felt the cost and distances kept that dream out of reach, then Nova Scotia and the Margaree River may well be the ideal place to give it a try. It's relatively close to all the major cities in Central and Eastern North America, is easily accessed by air and road, and the cost is ridiculously low. A one-week non-residence license is only $60. The riverbed is composed mainly of gravel, making it easy to wade, and the pools are easily accessible from a good network of roads that run parallel to the river on both sides. It really is an outstanding place to come and learn the sport of Atlantic salmon angling. And with a ton of other nearby attractions, it's also a great place to bring a non-fishing spouse or the whole family for an unforgettable vacation with a bit of angling on the side.
So Robert, tell me about the salmon season here on the Margaree River.
The salmon season on the Margaree opens on the 1st of June, and we fish right on through till the end of October. Our summer fishing is June, July, and August, where we're fishing mostly with smaller, sparser wet flies and dry flies. And then in the fall, we get a distinct fall run of large fish that come in. And at that time, we're normally fishing with larger flies.
And it's interesting, we're here actually in the transition zone. We're right at the end of summer, at the beginning of fall. The fall colors are coming on here in the hardwood forests of Cape Breton Island. And so everything's in play. It could be dry fly, it could be wet fly. It's good to take the temperature to know where you're at. It could be very interesting.
Yes.
So folks, we're up here at Ward's Rock Pool. It's a beautiful pool and it's one of the highest on the river. A short distance upriver is Sanctuary, and it's where the fish go to spawn, beyond which we're not allowed to angle. So at this point, we have literally fished from the bottom of the river all the way up to the top. And that's not something you can do everywhere, is it, Robert?
Well, what's nice about Nova Scotia salmon rivers is that they're public. We have no private water here, so anglers are able to fish anywhere they choose on the river. If we have a raise of water and certain sections are producing more than others, anglers can access those areas on the river.
I would recommend hiring a good guide like this fella and some of the other boys here on the river because they know the river and you don't at first. But once you've gone out a few times, then you can start picking your way up and down the river, and it really is a pretty sweet deal. You can just follow your own salmon instincts.
In salmon fishing, an important factor in deciding whether we should fish a dry fly or a wet fly is water temperature. So I'm checking my thermometer and the water temperature is 52 degrees. Anytime the water is above 50 degrees Fahrenheit, it's suitable for dry fly fishing. Once the water gets below 50 degrees, normally we're fishing wet flies.
When you're fishing for Atlantic salmon or any other species that is in a river with flowing water, the speed that the fly crosses through their window of vision is very important. In fast water, you may want to throw an upstream mend in order to slow the fly down as it goes through that fast current so the fish has a time to see it and come up and grab it. If it's whipping by really fast, he won't even see it, and if he does, he'll miss it. Conversely, if you're in slow water, you may want to throw a downstream mend so that it forms a belly in the line and it drags or pulls your fly through that slower water, giving it an enticing speed and movement. Folks, we're at the Forks Pool in Margaree River. Robert is one of the top guides on the river. Tell us a little bit about this place.
Well, right here behind us, we have the Southwest Branch that flows into the main Northeast Branch of the Margaree River.
So there and there. And
the pool we have behind us is called the Forks Pool. Every major river has tributaries, and normally where two rivers join, there's oftentimes a Forks Pool, and mm-hmm. This is the Margaree's Forks Pool. It's one of the best fish-producing pools on the river. Because the two rivers come together here, the pools below the Forks seem to be a little larger than the upper river pools.
No trip to the valley would be complete without a visit to the Margaree Salmon Museum, located in a former one-room schoolhouse in Margaree Center. Every river has a story, and here is where Margaree's is chronicled in loving detail. This award-winning museum features exhibits of vintage flies from some of the world's great tires, as well as antique fishing tackle, rods and reels, and stories of some of the colorful characters that have been part of the river's history. People like John Kosseboom, the inventor of the famous Kosseboom series of salmon flies, and the legendary Lee Wolfe, who began his lifelong obsession when he hooked his first Atlantic salmon here in 1933. The valley is equally famous for its hospitality and wonderfully friendly people. Combined with its beautiful open waters and dirt-cheap angling fees, it's no wonder folks keep coming here from around the corner and around the world.
I live in Australia during the winter and come up here from June to the end of October for there's incredible fishing throughout the season. And the reason I come back to this river is the quality of the fishing. There's nothing like it. You can find spots where you're in the middle of beautiful, crystal clear waters, 15, 18 pound silver fish coming up, taking a dry fly in the fall, set tight on a 12 pounder in the current, high water like this, just beautiful water. There's nothing like it. Nothing like it anywhere.
You never know who you'll meet on the river, but you're always guaranteed to make some new friends along the way. In this case, we ran into English angler Nick Lagatola, who was working his 15-foot spey rod in the classic British style.
This is my first time here in Canada fishing for salmon, and I've thoroughly enjoyed it. I think the place is extraordinarily beautiful. It's a paradise for a salmon angler. There's salmon in the river as we speak. I caught two yesterday, and the value is tremendous. For $60, you can have a permit for a week to fish for salmon, whereas in Scotland, you'll be spending 10 times that, at least, to fish for a day.
And so we invited Nick to join us as we headed downriver to fish some of the largest pools on the river, like Seal Pool, where a fellow can really stretch out and use his double-hander to full advantage. Nick also got to try his hand at dry fly fishing for the first time, something they don't do much of back home in Britain. And then we headed down to one of our favorite pools, Tidal Pool, at the very bottom of the river.
When you're fishing Atlantic salmon or steelhead or any sea-running trout, the anadromous fishes that move from the ocean and into freshwater rivers, there's always going to be at least one tidal pool. Sometimes they'll refer to it as the head of tide or a tidal pool. In this case, we're here at a tidal pool. What that means is that when the tide is high in the ocean nearby, it will push water up the estuary and up into the tidal pool. It will slow the current down. You'll actually see a rise of water at high tide. And then it will start to fall. Fishing tidal pools for anadromous fish can be very productive, or it can be a complete blank. And sometimes that's frustrating for anglers to figure out.
And suddenly, Nick is tight to a nice Atlantic salmon fresh from the sea.
That's a good run. I got my drag on quite tight, too.
Are you into backing or running line?
Not yet. This is running line.
Got her. Oh, that's a strong fish.
Good fish.
The hook set is just perfect, right in the scissors of the jaw.
Well done. Thank
you. There you go. There she goes. Nick, congratulations.
Fantastic.
Fabulous.
Job well done.
Nice to fish on the Margaree, isn't it?
Wonderful. Perfect place.
So now, you were fishing the Green Machine. Have you ever fished that fly before?
No, this is a local pattern, I believe. It's not something we would use in Europe at all.
It's extremely popular in eastern Canada. Well, congratulations. The Margaree River has been kind to you, and you've
certainly
been...
Has.
Having a very good trip.
Back at our cabin at the Normoy Inn that evening, Robert and I decided to tie up some fresh flies for the morning. There's something special about a night before a fly. Maybe it's because you know the places and conditions you'll be fishing in the next day, and you tie your flies to suit them. Or maybe it's just because those are the flies you're most likely to use. One way or another, there's always a bit of magic that makes them work very well. After dinner, we walk down the lane to the Red Barn for an old-fashioned Cape Breton ceilidh, or party, featuring live local Gaelic and Acadian musicians as good as you'll hear anywhere. These cultures and their music are alive and well on Cape Breton Island. The hills fairly echo with the sound of fiddles. A perfect end to another perfect day in the Margaree Valley. Using 9 to 10 foot single-handed rods and 12 to 15 foot double-handed rods, matched with standard and large arbor reels loaded with 8 and 9 weight floating lines. Leaders are 9 to 12 feet long, tapered down to 8-pound test tippets. Recommended flies for the Margaree include standard hairwing wet flies like the Cossaboom and Ross Special, two Canadian classics invented and popularized on this river. Also, spun deer hair bomber style dry flies like the Carter's Bug and buck bug style wet flies like the very popular Green Machine. As well as soft tackle marabou streamers such as the Green Slime Muddler and the Canary.
Hi, Dave McDonald, standing in front of the Normanway Inn, which has been standing here since 1928, greeting salmon anglers as they drive in our beautiful driveway. And we hope you'll consider doing the same. Once you get here, we have rooms in the inn to choose from. We've also got some cabins we built in the 1940s, cozy little places, and then more from later years, with jacuzzis, wood stove fireplaces, front porches. And they offer a great measure of privacy for the angler who wants to have his own escape. And then we also have a building with some beautiful suites, both one and two bedroom, very close to our music barn. And that's the place to be on Wednesday nights in July and August, and Fridays in September, October, and late June. So we hope you'll come out here and enjoy some fabulous food in our dining room. We serve breakfast, dinner, packed lunches for the river. So lots of great reason to come here, and we sure hope you will.
One of the nice things about fishing in Nova Scotia is that you can move around at will. For a change of pace, we decided to take a road trip to visit the lovely Middle River, a short 20 minutes away. The Middle, like its nearby twin, the Bedeck, hosts a nice run of Atlantic salmon in the fall. These are only two of several smaller salmon rivers that ring the Cabot Trail, and each has its own unique charms and is well worth a visit. Try as we might, we couldn't seem to entice a fish to our flies. It seemed we were still a bit early for the fall run. So we decided to head over to the nearby Glenora Distillery, North America's only single malt whiskey distillery, located in the Mabu Highlands near Lake Ainslie. We toured the distillery with manager Angus Hubbard, getting a first-hand look at how they produce their award-winning single malt whiskies, using water from the spring-fed brook that flows down from the mountains and through the Glenora property. Then we stopped into their pub for a bit of that famous Cape Breton fiddle music and a wee dram of their special Glen Breton Rare single malt. Delicious. But then, all too soon, it was time for us to take our leave. Thank you.
So we've gone down the faster water at the head of the run with a wet fly, and now I think it's time to change as the water gets softer onto a dry fly. One of my favorites is the Carter's Bug. It's a standard bomber pattern with a few variations. It's quite drab. Great high-floating fly, and the fish just seem to love it. It's become my favorite dry fly for Atlantic salmon, so I think we'll give that a try.
Margaree salmon are educated fish, in the same way as the trout of the Henry's Fork are educated, by seeing a lot of flies. So when it all comes together and you hook up with one, it's all the more sweet, especially on a dry.
Oh, what a nice dry fly take that was. Robert, my good man, would you be so kind as to come and tail this fish? I suspect there is more fight in this fish, but... Okay, Robert, can you wait out? There he is. Good job, Robert. Oh, nice. It's about a 10-pound male, I would say. Got it out. Okay, the fly is away. Why don't we show him to the camera here for a quick second? There you go. And there he goes. Well, it's been an awesome trip here to the Margaree. We've had a real ball. I want to thank you, Robert, for your great guiding and for fishing with us. It's been a pleasure.
Well, my pleasure, Ray. It's always a great time when we fish together.
Indeed. And I want to thank the folks at the Norma Way Inn who have been wonderful, and all the people that we've met along the way. One of the friendliest rivers I've ever fished, and that continues to be the case. Folks, if you want to learn more about this show or others in our series, visit us on the web at www.thenewflyfisher.com. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you next week.
Be sure to subscribe. Every Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, we're putting out new videos just for you.